So, good late afternoon, everybody, and welcome here, and especially welcome to the Fish family members. It's a great honor for me to be standing here this afternoon and speak to you.
I'm just playing with the door, sorry.
Okay. Yes, we are here to honor Professor Frank Fish. I put together here a little slide so we can just learn a bit about who he was for those that might not know. He was born in 1924, and shortly after the war, he got his B Farm degree here from University of London. Then in 1949, he became an assistant lecturer of pharmacognosy, or in pharmacognosy, at University of Glasgow. It was the same year he married his wife Mary. I guess it's because they moved to Scotland. And then in 1955, he got his PhD from Glasgow. And at some point, I've not been able to find out, but I'm sure the family could assist with that information. He moved to University of Strathclyde, where he stayed until he was offered the deanship here in London in 78. And he remained in this position until he became an emeritus professor, until his death in 2011. And we are standing here, or I'm standing here, and you are sitting here listening in the memory of his life work. And I've been looking into what that actually entailed. Because now you can just Google a person and you can look into the web of science and see everything a person has published. And it became very clear to me that it was Xanthoxylum, it was alkaloids of the genus Xanthoxylum. This is this fantastic thorn tree of Africa. So I could see that we are sharing a common interest and love of African plants. And I then also put together a little slide about myself, so you know the background for what I'm going to say here. I got my basic education in Copenhagen, and then I moved to South Africa, first as a postdoc and then a senior lecturer. And then I was headhunted back to Copenhagen in 2002 in pharmacognosy and became the head of natural products in 2010. And in this period, I also became the director of a new museum we established, a Naturmedizinsk Museum. And then I've been the president of the International Society for Ethnopharmacology. Yeah, just a little bit of background. Yes, Michael mentioned traditional medicine, and that is what we're going to talk about. And we saw this statement in a talk earlier this afternoon. 80% of the world's population is using traditional medicine. No one knows where this statement comes from. We don't know whether it is really true, but it is probably fairly true. Yeah, but that's okay if it's 60% or 70% or 80% doesn't really matter. And why are so many people using traditional medicine? Of course, there is a limited access to Western or allopathic medicine for the majority of our planet's population. But we must still remember where people can choose between the two systems, they might not always choose the Western system. There could, for example, be the so-called traditional diseases that a Western doctor does not know. If he or she does not know the disease, how can you expect that person to treat me? So, depending on what's wrong with you, you might opt to go to a traditional healer or practitioner instead. Good. Where do we find traditional medicine? We have documented systems in Asia, in India, Tibet, and China. And then basically in the rest of the world, we have shamanism. We find it in the Arctic, in Siberia, with the Indians in North and South America, in Africa, and the Aboriginals in Australia. But what about here? I see someone nodding. If we go back, now I come from Scandinavia, if we go back to the pre-Christian times, we had the vulva that was a female diviner that the Vikings had. The question is, what about the witches? Were they shamanists? We don't know. Much of the knowledge went up in smoke. Yeah, so we might have had a tradition or we might not. Folk medicine today is not shamanism here. But what is shamanistic healing? I've been talking about the diviner. That is the central person or central caregiver, central practitioner. They work through contact with the ancestors. And here the ancestors are the spirits of the forefathers. You get into contact with them through dreams or trances. Trances can be induced by drumming, dancing, or drugs. I've also been wondering if diviners have special perceptive abilities. This might, maybe just a speculation, be genetic. It normally runs in families. This position is inherited. It goes from father to son or mother to daughter. So maybe some people have a disposition to be able to do things like that. I also want to point out that in traditional societies, the healer has a lot of power. The medicine man can put a spell on you if you are not keeping to the taboos. So they are also keepers of the social structure. Yeah, and as Michael sort of was implying, I went through a bit of training. You see me here with my fellow student and my two trainers. You cannot yourself, at least not in Africa, decide to become a traditional healer or a sangoma. It is the ancestors that select you. You will start falling ill, getting some unknown disease that a Western doctor will not recognize. When you then speak to a traditional healer, they can recognize that this is a so-called sangoma disease, that you have been selected. You are then sent home and you will, in a dream within a short period, dream about who will train you. And you will then go to that person and become an apprentice. It's called a twasa in Africa. In the first few months, you will take an individual medicine. You will have a strict diet, daily routines, and maybe dancing at night, sort of to keep you in line. And after that, the training of perceptive abilities will start, and of course you will learn how to use medicinal plants. I want to say here that I have not fulfilled the many years of training, so I am still only a twasa. It was never my intention to become a practicing sangoma, but I think the ancestors selected me to get a much deeper insight into traditional medicine so I could bridge the gap between traditional medicine and science. That is how I believe this all happens. Yeah, so what does a sangoma do? Now I could see the patients that came to my trainers. Of course, it would be medical problems. And so not so surprising, mental and psychological problems. But I realized there was also a lot of social and family problems. And if we start thinking about it, these are probably linked. If you have problems in your family, you get these that might lead into mental problems. Then there was something like the weather. That might sound a bit ridiculous for you sitting here this afternoon, but if you live in Africa and you are dependent on your crop and it doesn't rain, then you know that your children and maybe yourself will starve. So it might be nice if the healer could get a little cloud coming in the sky. Then there's something else, protection of property. South Africa is a very crime-ridden society, and for example, your car would often be stolen. Then you can go to the sangoma and get a small thing you put in the front screen of your car. And do you think it will work? It might very well work because the thieves are afraid of the traditional healer. And if they see this little mark on the car, they don't take your car, they take one next door. So in that way, it actually works. Yeah, but it worked. Yeah, so what we can see here is that traditional healing is holistic. It has cultural, it has spiritual, psychological, and medical aspects. Now, as scientists, we cannot dabble into these first aspects, but we can concentrate on the medicinal plants. And that is what we should do. And here are a few pictures from medicinal plant markets. This is where I lived in Pietermaritzburg in South Africa. And you can see it's relatively primitive on the pavement, at least here, material placed on a newspaper, not directly on the pavement. Then we have a similar market from China, slightly more organized, and it can even be properly packaged in a nice shop. So it's just showing the span of ways traditional medicine can be sold. Yeah, back in Copenhagen, I have this People and Plant Medicine program. And this afternoon, I'm going to show you a few examples of what we are working on in these different areas here. But basically, what we have tried to do is come up with evidence-based traditional medicine. Yeah, let's start out with central nervous system active plants. We were a bit intrigued by a statement we read that there are no psychoactive plants in Africa. Africa is a huge continent, so it seemed a bit sort of incredible that it should be like that. Many of the early recordings on plant use were recorded by monks. And we had a suspicion that these very devout Christians that went out to Africa maybe 100 years ago or earlier, they did not like plants that were used for something magic, something that could be seen as devil worship and things like that. So they might not have recorded that kind of plant use. Further, during apartheid, traditional medicine was outlawed. It was directly called witchcraft. But of course, it did not mean that there was no traditional medicine. At the end of apartheid, there were between 200,000 and 300,000 traditional healers in South Africa. You can never outlaw something like that. And can you read this? I made it very small letters, but I think it's safe here in London to say this. It says, no Americans. If we look at the similar situations in the Amazonas, during the 60s, there were a number of American scientists going there to look for recreational drugs. That never happened in Africa. So there might still be hidden secrets. So we started recording uses and built a database on South African mental health plants that has over 300 plant species. If we could sort of put them into indication groups. And today we can only look at like one example in the anxiety and depression area. And I also have to say in Zulu, there's no word like depression. They don't have a word like that. They don't know the disease. But they have another condition that is called put down by the spirits. That has symptoms very similar to what we call depression. So plants that are used when you are put down by the spirits, we have included here in depression plants. And you can see we have set up a battery of assays in connection with depression, both in vitro and in vivo assays. So we tested 34 indigenous plant species. We started out very easily with a serotonin reuptake transporter, and we found 5 plants that had promising activity. And the one we are looking at today is this beautiful bulb flower, Bufana distica. If we read here from a book on what the plant is used for, we can see weak decoctions will sedate violent psychotic patients. Normal decoctions will give sedation, visual hallucination, blah, 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 until maybe coma. So we can from this see we have a powerful plant here. Here we see it out in the field. You can see the leaves here. This is my PhD student, Gary Stafford. Ooh, that went a bit too fast. So we tested it for, we already knew it had activity in a serotonin transporter, but we also tested it for noradrenaline and dopamine just to see how selective it was. And then we tested it in animal assays, the mouse tail suspension assay. It's very simple assay. You inject the extract into the mouse, and then you hang it by the tail. And then you see how long it's fighting. And you then record the time. The longer it's fighting, the less depressed it is, if a mouse can be depressed. But that is this type of assay. It's the same in the forced swimming assay, or swim test. Here, the mouse or the rat is put into a cylinder of water, and you see how long it's swimming. It's trying to keep up. At some point, it will give up, and it will just hang there. But now, don't be scared. It will not die. It will not drown. You know they're living in the sewers, so they have developed a way that they can just float with just the nose over the water. But again, the longer it's fighting, the less depressed it is supposed to be. And we found significant activity in all three animal assays. Then we wanted to find out what is the active compound. So we made an extract from the bulbs, we did a classical separation, and then onto HPLC. And in each of these steps, we used the bioassay to follow the activity. So we took the active fractions all the time, till we had a pure compound that we could take to NMR. And it revealed that we actually got four different compounds out, these bufanamine type alkaloids. So in this way, we could show the mode of action and what the active compounds are. In this way, giving scientific evidence for the traditional use. So that was the first example. Then we go on to maternal health. That was a UN goal of 2015, that means last year. If we look at the data, then in our part of the world, one in 3,700 women died during childbirth, whereas the figures are different in sub-Saharan Africa. There it is dangerous to get a child. WHO also had another task, that is contraception, to prevent 33 million unwanted pregnancies, to then prevent a lot of women from dying, both from the pregnancy and childbirth, but also from unsafe abortion. And the project we worked on originated because I got an email from a Danish medical doctor working in Tanzania. It turned out that the nursing staff working at the hospital knew a lot about plants used for abortion, and they got women in that they could see had an unsafe abortion. Now it is so that abortion is illegal in Tanzania, and you are punished by imprisonment if you help. So these nurses could not be seen to help these women. And now you can say, why did they get pregnant? But that is maybe a very moralistic question if you start looking at reality. When I read reports on these girls and women, I could see that they are in trouble. There are two categories, especially big groups here, schoolgirls that are forced into a kind of semi-prostitution, and then they get pregnant. And at the moment you're pregnant, you are no longer allowed to go to school in Tanzania. You are kicked out. And that is the end of their hopes for the future. Then it's married women with too many children. They cannot feed yet another child. Yeah, here's just a few pictures from a nice place, a place with slightly fewer resources, and then the reality for very many people or women in a country like Tanzania that they cannot afford or they cannot get to a clinic. So they have to rely on a traditional healer. So we got 21 of these abortion plants. And the big question here is, could they contract the uterus? We made extracts of all the plants. We got nice small animals. These are female rats, and we had to have them when they were in oestrus, particular point in the menstrual cycle. And then we took out the uterus. And you see it here in an organ bath. Here it's not contracted, and here it's contracted. And you can also see there's a string attached that will record here on the computer every time it contracts. So when we get a peak, it's contracted. And we can then add the plant extract into the organ bath and see what happens. And results would look like this. The more extract we added, the more contractive response we would get, so it would go up. So that was the force of the contractions. But we also looked at the frequency of the contractions. Nothing happened in the lower doses, but then here we got 5 contractions in 10 minutes and here 13. So either we can make the contractions stronger or we can increase the speed with which the contractions happen. So out of these 21 plants, 11 could increase the force, 12 could amend the frequency, and 7 species could do both. So clearly, the people or the women in Tanzania know about plants that can do this. In this case, this is abortion. But I was thinking of another use for these plants as well. We still have the problem of 250,000 women that die annually due to postpartum bleeding. These plants could also be used to contract the uterus in these cases here to maybe make it possible for these women to survive. Yeah. Then we move to another project, which is about snake bites. And this is tissue necrosis after snake bite. But a little bit of background. We have about 3,000 snakes in the world, of which 600 are venomous. And we find them basically all over the world. We have 2.5 million people being bitten each year and 125,000 dying. Everybody agrees that these figures are far too low. There are a lot of dark figures here that are never recorded. So this led to the WHO declaring snake bites a neglected tropical disease in 2009. But if we look into what happens when a snake bites, it's biting to kill its prey. So firstly, we have some neurotoxins or cardiotoxins that will kill the prey. But you also know that the snake has no teeth, built, of course, they had the 2 fangs. But it cannot chew up its prey. We have a pet snake at home, and even it's, okay, now it's more than a meter long. But it's amazing how it can open the mouth and eat a big mouse. But it's eaten or swallowed whole. So it would just be in the stomach of the snake. But luckily, it has injected it with enzymes that can dissolve the prey from the inside. That is these compounds here. And if we look at what they do, proteases, we can hear they will break down proteins. So they will cause tissue necrosis and also cause a hemorrhagic activity. That means when you can't stop the bleeding at a snake bite. We also have phospholipases that will create inflammation at the bite site. And then we have hyaluronidase that degrades the lining and the tissue so the other toxins can spread into the body. It's also called the spreading factor. And we here see some examples. These are sort of minor bites. This is an 11-year-old boy from Ecuador that was bitten 2 weeks earlier. It's not so nice. The only good thing is you see the green cloth here, so he's now in hospital and can have his leg amputated. Yeah, so the aim of this project was to find plants to treat necrosis after snake bite. I have to emphasize the first treatment should be antiserum to stop the toxic effects. But antiserum will not prevent the tissue necrosis. So the idea here was to see, can we find some plant medicines that could be used to prevent the necrosis that will often leave people with a handicap or something like that they cannot carry on in life. So we created a database on traditional use plants, tested them, and then identifying active compounds and port the results back to the local communities that need this information. Yeah, so we started data mining here. Information from 6 continents, 61 countries, in total just over 1,500 plant species. I also want to just mention this here about signature plants. You know a lot of plants that are called snake roots. Or if you look at the Latin name, Rauwolfia serpentina, the snake-like Rauwolfia. When we did statistical analysis on the database, we could see that there was not an overrepresentation of plants that resemble or look like snakes. So that was a very good thing, because we had been a bit afraid that we would see this in the recordings. Yeah, here we have a world map, and we see the black areas are where people are being bitten the most. And the white circles are our collection areas. So we tried to get plants from different parts of the world. We here see some pictures from our expedition to the Amazonas. We needed to go in by canoe because that was the only way to get there. And then collection in the rainforest, and here plant material drying. And I just wanted to here show the plant press for documentation of the plant material. And the example we will look at, we then made extracts of these things and tested them in the assays. So we set up microtiter-based assays for these enzymes. And instead of this one, you could have bought from Sigma, the other ones probably not. But we decided to use the snake venom as the source of the enzymes, partly because there are isoenzymes in. But then it would be the real situation. And we also saw that we need venom from the snakes from where we collect the plants. It would not help to find a plant in China that would work against a snake in South America, or vice versa. Yeah, so the example I'm going to share with you here today is from China on Clausina excavata from the Rutaceae family that works against the Chinese moccasin snake, or at least is used traditionally against it. What we do is we prepared an extract, injected it in the HPLC, and got a normal UV chromatogram. Then some of the eluent would run into a microtiter plate, and we could then do the assay, and maybe this and this well would show activity corresponding to, let's say, one of these minor peaks here. This minor peak could then be trapped on SPE and run directly into NMR or to MS, so we could get the structure of the compound. In this way, we didn't need to do a big bioassay-guided fractionation isolation thing. And we could sort of more or less directly pinpoint the active compounds. And here we see the HPLC chromatogram, here the UV. And down here we have what we call a biochromatogram. When it goes down, we have activity. So it's opposite here where you have a peak each time you have a compound. This is the injection peak, and here we think this is tannins that we cannot really see here. But out here where we have the compound, we have one single peak of activity corresponding to compound number 6, which very quickly by NMR could be elucidated to be this compound here, lanthanamide B. And if we look at the activity, we had IC50 values similar to the control compound, the positive control isostatic acid. Yeah, and all this could be done with 150 milligram of dry plant material, that is like a quarter of a teaspoon. So it just shows you how powerful all these new technologies are. But when we started looking overall at the whole project, when we had all the data in after several years of work, our conclusion had to be that we did not see much effect of any of the plants in preventing tissue necrosis. So we cannot recommend the use of plants for snake bites. Yeah, then we jump to another part of the world. This is just a little intermezzo. About the third Danish Pamir expedition in 2010 to the Wakhan corridor of Afghanistan. That is this little corridor here, part of the Silk Road. Ooh, it goes very fast when I do that. Up there in this valley lives the Wakhi people. There are 16,000 individuals. They are Indo-Europeans. As you can see here, they have blonde hair and blue or green eyes. They have been in the valley for the last 2,000 years at least. No one knows exactly how they got there, but they must at some point have been trapped there in all the travels that happened at that time. So this is my, at that time he was a master student. He has just handed in his PhD. Michael is his examiner. But he decided all by himself to go to Afghanistan, hiring some people and some horses and set off. Here you could still go by 4x4. And as we saw this afternoon in Tony's talk, you very quickly had to change into horses. And they had slightly better accommodation than that piece of plastic Tony was sleeping under. and they, this was the last bridge they could pass. After that, they had to get through the water. And they had to go pass, get over passes of 5,000 meters, so they had to rent yaks. And notice the plant press, the most important tool you have in these areas. Okay, so Jens was sitting, every little village or settlement they got to, he was interviewing people on their plant use. And actually they were very happy to share information. And here we have put together a little table, and I have highlighted a few things that is maybe a little bit unusual from other such inventories. Skin moisteners, they had quite a lot of plants being used for that. But if you start thinking that these people live in the high mountains with very high UV radiation and a dry wind, their skin will suffer. So that's maybe not so strange after all. Respiratory problems, they also had a number of plants for. And if we go one slide back, we see a central fireplace in the middle of their house or their tent. This creates a lot of smoke. So you will get respiratory problems if you live in a place like that. Then we have high blood pressure. Also many plants for that. And I could suspect it has to do with the salt tea they are enjoying. They get far too much salt. And from that, probably high blood pressure. And we also see, as Tony showed, a plant used for altitude sickness. Now, but what I'm going to share with you today is something that has to do with this little mite. It's living in their houses and might cause an anaphylactic shock that will lead to the death of people. So nearly everybody carries an antidote in their pocket. It is the root of Rubia tibetica. So we made an extract of this, both water and ethanol extracts, and we got a guinea pig. We had to have it driven up by car from Holland. There was no one breeding guinea pigs in Denmark any longer. No, but again, we took out, here it was the ileum we used, as I showed you before, an organ bath. And here we added the plant extract. You can see it has become colored. So we added first the plant extract, and then we added cumulative doses of histamine. The special thing about the guinea pig ileum is that it has a lot of histamine receptors. So when there's histamine, it will contract. And we see that here in this slide. Here we have increasing histamine concentrations and a contractile response. The wide open circle here is histamine by itself, and you can see it contracts the ileum. If we added mepiramine, the black circles, it's a well-known anti-inflammatory compound. You might get it here as a cream for mosquito bites or stings of different kinds, then you can see that it could partly prevent the action of histamine. All the other curves here is the extract, and you can see in the highest dose, it could completely block the effect of histamine. So, in fact, the root of Rubia tibetica possess antihistamine activity and can work as an antidote. Now Jens went back. He has produced a school book on the plants of the Wakhan that he went out to Kabul to have printed and then bring up to the mountains. And he then informed people about these results. And they were, of course, they knew it worked, but they were very happy to have scientific evidence that, yes, they were right. Yeah, then we move to the last of the examples for today. It's maybe a bit ambitious, but I have called it, and that is what I'm currently working on. I've called it finding the world's best plants for type 2 diabetes. I think if we are doing this, we have to be ambitious. If we look at type 2 diabetes in numbers, we heard a talk this afternoon where we just saw that it was increasing. We have nearly 400 million people in the world suffering from type 2 diabetes, and surprisingly enough, very many of them live in low and middle income countries. And I just checked the statistics from the UK. You have 3.5 million diabetes sufferers here. So my claim is that some of these patients would prefer a herbal drug if that herbal drug works. So the aim is to find the best plants in the world, and then we need to get them to the market. I've always been a very academic. So all this commercialization is a very new thought to me. But on the other hand, we can make all these results. We write them up in papers. Earlier on, they were sitting in a library. Now they don't even do that. They are in a server somewhere. But it means really nothing. We need to get it from the science to the patient. So we need to find a way to do that. Yeah. But you, probably many of you will know that diabetes is not one disease. We have the symptom of hyperglycemia, too much glucose in the blood. But that can be caused by many different conditions. So because of that, we have set up a type 2 diabetes pharmacological platform with a number of different assay models. Today we are going to talk about this first one. This is the very simple one on the digestive enzymes. When you eat a meal, a carbohydrate meal, it passes down through the gastrointestinal tract. At some point, it will meet alpha amylase secreted by the pancreas. That will chop the carbohydrates into smaller units that will then continue down here in the and then at some point it will meet other enzymes, alpha-glucosidases, that will do the final chopping, so we get free glucose that can be absorbed into the blood. After such a meal, a normal person, this is a time, hours after the meal, and this is a plasma glucose, a normal person will get a little increase in the blood glucose, whereas a diabetic patient will get this huge peak in the postprandial blood glucose. That is dangerous. The green curve here is a pre-diabetic person. So, if we could inhibit these enzymes, we could maybe prevent these high peaks in the blood glucose after eating. There are three compounds on the market: arcabose, miglitol, and voglibose. We are using arcabose as our control compound. We decided to focus on the other enzyme, alpha amylase, because there has not been so much work on that. And we set the inclusion criteria to 10 micrograms per milliliter for the IC50 value. I know it's low, but we, as I started out saying, we have to be ambitious. If we cannot meet a criteria like that, then I think we should forget about it. So, there were very few studies already that could meet a criteria like that. We see them here. And there was only one species that had not already had quite a bit of work on it, so we decided to focus on the Sorbus species. You also know them as rowan berries. As we heard Monique saying earlier today, it could be it could be an advantage to get all the material from the same place, because then you don't have a geographical or climatic variation. So we cycled on our bicycles into the botanical gardens. They luckily had 16 different sorbus species, so we collected them. And we then tested them, and you here see the curves. And this is a logarithmic scale, so you can also easily see that we had a 100-fold difference in the IC50 values. We here have a table with the activities for both enzymes, and now I mark the active compound or active extracts. Three of them fulfilled this criterion of the 10 microgram per milliliter. And then when I started looking at it, then I realized something. You see these leaves? They are not what I would normally think of as Warren berries. So we had to become a bit botanical and look into the taxonomy. And it turned out that Sorbus has 6 subgenera. And if we look at them, then the one called Sorbus has these pinnate leaves that I would normally think of as Rowan berries. This other subgenus has 1 species, and about the simple leaf ones, these 2 also only has 1 species each, and all the others are called Aria. If we look at a phylogeny, this is a DNA-based phylogeny, and I immediately say that where this arrow is, this continues, but it couldn't be on one slide, so this would be a very long thing. Then we have the simple leaf placed here and the pinnate leaves over here. So they're not even in the same clade. They most likely don't belong together. So at some point when someone, maybe at Kew, will do a revision of the Rosaceae, we will not find these Aria species as being part of Sorbus. Yeah. We then took the most active of these extracts and took it in vivo. We induced diabetes by injecting the mice with this compound that will destroy the pancreas. We just needed to check that it worked. This is non-diabetic mice, and you can see after this is the time after they eat, and this is the blood glucose. We can see this little increase in the blood glucose, whereas those mice we had treated got this big, dangerous peak. Here we then gave the extract. We had calculated from the in vitro study that this should be the equivalent doses to where we could see activity with arcabose in the mice. We have arcabose here in the blue curve. That would lower up to the blue curve from the animals that were not treated. And we could see that here in the green curve, the extract also worked. We then tried a lower dose, 900 milligrams. We again saw we prevented the dangerous peak in the blood glucose. With 600 milligrams, yeah, we did it at the same time, but you also see like a shift here. It comes later, so it's sort of shifting it to the side, but we saw this was not good. It was still too high. So from this, it would look like this is the clinical dose of arcabose, 25 milligrams 3 days daily. So of the Sorbus extract, we would have to take 900 milligrams 3 times daily. And we can just pack 900 milligrams into 1 capsule. So it would be possible. It again shows if the plant extract does not have an IC50 value of below 10 micrograms per milliliter, you would have to eat a huge bowl of plant extract. We have to be ambitious here. But this could actually work. Yeah. Then the final few minutes I have left, I just want to say something about superiority of plants. As we all know, plants contain many compounds. It might be many active compounds that could work in synergy. But we could also have that the compounds could work on different disease targets. We have for the last 100 years worked on a paradigm with one pill, one compound, one target. I think things are changing back again. So we have a plant, several compounds, several targets. I've also illustrated it here. This is the old paradigm. We have a drug that works with strong specific action on a target that will influence the disease. Over here, I've tried to illustrate it. This is a plant extract with many active compounds that will work on different targets. This is often different proteins. These targets might also modulate each other, and in this way, we get an effect on one or more diseases. This is called network pharmacology. And as it says here, network pharmacology, the next paradigm in drug discovery. I think we are now beginning to be able to look into the black box of why are plants working. So I actually think we are right at the doorstep of a new bright future for plants as medicine. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anna, for this journey, sharing your journey from Copenhagen to Pietermaritzburg and back to Copenhagen, and all the developments in medicinal plant research. I think we can take a few questions before we break up for refreshments, which will be served right in the Square Lounge. So if there are any questions? Raj.
In your discussion of the snake venom,
yeah,
and its your conclusion was that the plant extracts, the compounds extracted from those plants, didn't have any effect. But your last statement about network pharmacology, to what extent are the remedies prepared by local people using those plants, these multiple plants, and these other things besides just the plants that might account for the fact that they say it does work, or that there is such a lot of
Yes. I think you're right. We need to not, as we did, we looked at specific enzymes, and that is like one target we are looking at. And I think we need to change all our research into network pharmacology type research, where we can see how all these plant compounds are modulating different things. But if we look only at the specific enzymes we looked at, we did not see anything that would be promising. But it could also be an effect that it's calming people. So they, there can be many different effects that could work. And I'm not sure the placebo effect would work so well here, because it's...
The calming often happens as a result of kind of placebo effect.
No, but it could be sedative compounds in the plants. Yeah. Sorry?
Anti-inflammatory.
We only looked at these three enzymes that are directly involved in necrosis.
Can I just follow up? My point really was about looking at the recipes that traditional people, traditional doctors use, because they very rarely use them.
Yes.
Multiple plants. And that's certainly within ethnobotany, ethnopharmacology, that's a huge open field.
Yes. And what is being said here is that we should have looked not at individual plants, but at mixtures. And I fully agree. And that is also what we can do now with this network pharmacology. Because now we can start looking at complex mixtures. A plant extract in itself is complex. A plant extract of 10 plants is probably 10 times more complex. But these computer models can handle this. This network pharmacology is simulations in computers. But that will predict what we can expect and which effects we are likely to get. And that can be any effect, because you can modulate all this. And in this way, we might get indications from the computer that we should look in a completely different direction for the activity. Michael is leading this.
Interactions with the defined receptor?
I mean, in network pharmacology, that is purely computer based.
Yeah.
So you find out which compounds are known in this plant, you feed that into the computer, and then the computer data or the systems know which different enzymes or receptors or proteins these compounds are modulating. So it's all in silico. Okay. Yep.
On diabetes, you of course talked about one possibility. I saw on your long list of drugs being used for plants, cinnamon. That's, I know a lot of people do use it for breakfast, etc.
Mm.
Have you done any work on that?
Yes, we have worked on it, and it has inhibitors of these two enzymes I showed. Yes.
And for cinnamon, there are actually clinical data.
Yes.
Small,
yeah.
But there's some clinical evidence for it, which is always often limited simply by the size of the studies. Did you, Omar?
I just want to ask, when you consider combining different plants, when you were talking to the people living in the valley, did you find that, for example, they combined roots with leaves from different plants and bark? How do they actually use the plants? Did they process them beforehand? All that relevant?
Yes, of course that is relevant. I must say here, in total they had 31 medicinal plants. It's very few plants, but it's again a reflection that there are not many plants in the high mountains. Mostly they use them as single plants, which is also unusual that they are not mixing them. But maybe again there were not so many options of mixing plants when you have so few plants. Yes, that is relevant, and that was also recorded, and how they were prepared was recorded, yes, yeah.
Final one.
The South African bulb, you mentioned that has GABA activity.
Yeah.
How close is that to becoming a medicine, and also, what are there any patenting issues?
At that point, if we take the last thing first, at that point in time, we thought that it would be absolutely best not to patent but to get knowledge out so no one could patent, so it could stay traditional. No, there is no commercial medicines coming out, but there's a lot of traditional products on the market, or you can buy it from the traditional healers. And that is how we actually wanted to stay, that it is not a few people that should commercialize and earn a lot of money on it. It should be available to the people. No, they cannot, because now it's no, we have published it, so it's no longer novel knowledge. And that means it cannot be patented. Of course, it means that we treat or cheat the indigenous or local people, the owners of the indigenous knowledge, from ever patenting it. But again, if someone patents it, it's one or two or very few people that will benefit from it. And I believe that this is a traditional knowledge that a whole community holds. So it should benefit everybody, not a few people. And that's why I don't like the idea of patenting.
Mm-hmm. Is this direct on this one, Joe?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay.
Why will more people be able to use it?
Because it will be sold to a large number of patients.
It is.
If there isn't a financial model to exploit it commercially, then it just remains a traditional therapy within that area.
Yeah, okay, you will not get it to other parts of the world, but it is very easily available in South Africa. To anyone that goes to a multi-market or to a traditional healer will be able to buy it. I could fear it, at the moment it becomes commercialized, it will not be so easy to get hold of, and it will become a lot more expensive.
And the question, if I may add, Anna, is would there be enough funding available to cover the costs of this research and development, Ijoma, to get it to a level to actually becoming a proper herbal medical product, food supplement or licensed medicine? So very often, the whole project stops at a very early stage because of lack of funds. This is part of the, I think, very difficult situation. But may I suggest we continue in the Square Lounge?
Good idea.
Thank you very much again, Anna, for a very stimulating